So we'll see.
So if you think you're Mexican, check yourself. Okay. So the title of my presentation, right? Does Mexico exist? Or sort of trivial in a way, like of course Mexico exists. It might even be offensive to some. But I think that if you understand the history of colonialism in Mexico from a certain perspective that I think has not been properly yet investigated, it becomes a kind of an interesting question. So here's, so do I push it over to get it?
Right.
Okay. All right. So this is my main claim. Mexico is a settler society. In a moment, I'll sort of explain what I mean by that and what some difficulties that are presented in trying to advance this claim. Okay, so here's one way to think about it, and this is one way in which I think the answer to the question is yes. So if you think of Mexico as a sort of network of, you know, relationships of power that are encoded into the legal and political infrastructure of the state, that are imposed on unconsenting nations, and that are structurally committed to maintaining access to their territories and eliminating their autonomy, then yeah, Mexico exists in that sense. On the other hand, if you think of Mexico as an enduring people who share a cultural territory and a common ancestry, history, society, I'm not so sure that the question has an affirmative answer. Okay. So here's what's on the agenda. I want to start by addressing some initial difficulties with this proposal. Then I'll do a sort of short intro, actually probably not that short, but an intro of settler colonial theory. I want to propose a definition of nations and states that's offered from a perspective that I think, at least in the academy and in Latin America, in the case of Latin America, I haven't seen anywhere. And then I'm going to try to, so that's sort of setting up a sort of lens through which we will be able to see certain things in the Mexican history that we can come to recognize now as sort of settler processes. Okay, so here's the initial difficulties. There isn't an adequate translation of settler colonialism to Spanish, or I think Portuguese. So, and the term settler in English has a distinct sort of disapproval connotation, pejorative. In Spanish, the words for that are like colon, colonos, colonas, or pobladores in Portuguese. Those are just descriptive. They don't have the same connotation as, like, you know, bad person. Similarly, if you translate settler colonialism into Spanish, you get something like colonialismo de colones, or colonialismo de asentamientos. This is, by the way, a point that was made by a critical ethnic studies scholar, Adriana Castellanos. So it seems redundant, right? I think that that's just a verbal sort of linguistic issue. I think that the phenomena is real. The other difficulty is that traditionally, the way that people analyze colonialism in Mexico is through this rubric of what's called coloniality of power theory. That's where the focus isn't so much on the same things that settler colonialism is focused on. So the focus tends to be on resource extraction from Latin America, on the control and exploitation of labor, and that gets sort of mapped, so the explanation of racialization is that gets mapped onto the labor relations. And then there's also, I think, this lingering effect of the discourse of mestizaje, where that's been seen historically as the unique sort of defining feature of Latin America. And so the problem is, if you know, Latin America is a mestiza, then what do you make of them? Like, are they settlers or are they native? So there's a distinction in settler colonial theory of the settler and the native that becomes sort of an issue. Okay, what's settler colonialism? So the pioneering sort of theorist of this form of understanding colonialism is Patrick Wolfe. He's an Australian anthropologist structure of dispossession. And so that means that the organizing principle of settler societies is what he calls the logic of elimination. Now, the logic of elimination has sort of two aspects. One is a positive one and one is a negative one. So the negative one is that it strives for the dissolution of native societies, so it wants to eliminate the native. The positive one is that it wants to erect a new colonial society, or sorry, a new settler society on that expropriated land base. Here's a sort of update on the theory by Glenn Coulter, who's an indigenous First Nations scholar or philosopher from Canada. He's a Dene Yellowknives. Okay. He wrote a really important book called Red Skin, White Mask, so it's like a riff on the open on. And so here's what he says. He says, the settler colonial relationship is a relationship of power that's structured into these sets of relations that continue to facilitate over time the dispossession of indigenous lands, but also importantly of their self-determining authority. So there's going to be an important connection between this step, Alizu. Between lands and identity here. Okay, so here's something else about what elimination means, right? So it doesn't require biological genocide or physical elimination, but it can be encouraged through other strategies. So it can encourage miscegenation, it's relevant to Latin America, right? Breaking down of native land into individual freeholds, child abductions like the boarding schools here, this idea of kill the Indian, save the man. So you want to wrest away indigeneity from indigenous bodies. And the reason why is because that facilitates the dispossession of their lands. They no longer have the identity tied to the land. So settler colonialism destroys to replace. But it's never wholesale replacement. There's always a sort of contradictory sort of element where, as Patrick Wolf says, that their settler societies contain sort of resistant or refractory image of the native. So like symbolically attaching, settler national forms of nationalism to, attaching native images of natives to these settler nationalism. So like, the Boston Tea Party, does anybody know what happened? They dressed up, right? Like, what they thought indigenous people looked like, right? So they did that to assert their identity against the homeland. Griollos ended up doing the same sort of thing during the independence movement. Okay, what does the structure of dispossession look like? This is from Coulter. I think that one important way to understand it is to go back to some insights that we get from Karl Marx, and it has to do with like the concept of primitive accumulation. So Coulter does some really good, interesting work with that concept. And he says, this is the sort of the original Marxist formulation, where he says, capitalism, this is Marx, comes into the world dripping from head to toe, from poor and blood and dirt. So in a primitive accumulation, which is the process that Marx thought was needed in order to get capitalism off the ground, to accumulate a stock of capital, required dispossession, so you need to violently strip non-capitalist producers from the sources of their livelihood, which is the land. Enclosure, which is when you forcefully open up those lands that were previously held in common to privatization. And then obviously proletarianization, which is like, once those people are dispossessed, then in order for them to secure their livelihood, their lives, they have to come back and work for the landowners who have enclosed them. Here's the mistakes that Coulter identifies with this. The first thing is that it's a mistake to call it primitive, because that means it happened in the past. But the whole point of settler colonial theory is to show how this is a continual process. It's a form of structured dispossession. So unconcealed and violent enclosures happen all the time. So just think of no doubt. There's also sort of Eurocentrism that he identifies in that account, where he says that for some reason, also Marx tended to think that there was that the dispossessed would eventually benefit from that original dispossession. So you get the inherent injustice of colonialism sort of lost Marxist analysis identifies as the labor exploitation, right, and the loss of property, I guess. The loss of land, that's what I'm talking about. Okay. And then the last thing is that it's not, in that, that it's no longer needs coercive means. It doesn't need to be violent anymore. All you've really got to do is, this is kind of his big contribution in this book, is he shows that multicultural policies in Canada, in fact, reproduce the same structure of civil community. All right, so those are going to be useful when we're thinking about how Mexico worked out. Okay, there's one last thing here that I think is worth noting, is the way to fix those things, to fix these problems, and still retain the central insights of that account of accumulation by dispossession, is to shift from thinking about the class relation of exploitation to thinking about the colonial relation of dispossession of lands. Access to territory. So his slogan, Wolf has his slogan, Coulthard has his slogan too. He says, settler colonialism is territorially acquisitive in perpetuity. Okay. So an issue here is two opposing conceptions of the land, right? So on the one hand, for states, or settler states, that's the foundation for building and development. On the other hand, for indigenous people, that's the foundation of their material and spiritual sustenance. This is how Wolf puts it. So far as indigenous people are concerned, where they are is who they are. And Deborah Bird Rose says, did I put it up here? Yeah. To get in the way of settler colonialism or settler colonization, all the native has to do is stay at home. Shifting to this perspective that I want to recommend as well in our analysis of Mexico as a colonial society. So here's the first one. It exposes an inherent injustice in colonialism that was sort of lost in the Marxist analysis, which is this, that the commons belong to indigenous nations and they deeply inform indigenous ways of life. So it isn't just, you know, class exploitation, right? And it allows us to see this conception of the land that's different, distinct. It's not just a material place, but a place-based system of reciprocal relations. That's Coulthard's, the way that he articulates sort of what he thinks of as the indigenous conception of land. It also reveals that dispossession and not proletarian invasion is the dominant background field that shapes indigenous life. Right, so rather than class exploitation, and that indigenous anti-colonialism is primarily about land. Okay. He also thinks it allows us to see that we can view land as not just having merely instrumental value, but having perhaps intrinsic value, which is like, you know, that's not the Western view. Okay. Last one. So he thinks that it also allows us to have a sort of more expansive intersectional analysis. So colonial relations only occur, relations should be seen as the inherited background field, and within that field, you get different power effects depending on, you know, your rest, the other identity sort of axes. So like, for example, the particular vulnerabilities of indigenous women. Structure identity to the land or territory, or as one indigenous philosopher, Brian Burkhardt, puts it, locality. Okay, so now we're moving on to what are nations. So this is a perspective that started to be developed in the 80s called fourth world theories. although it can be sort of expanded from the recent work, and like in the few people who are working on this, it's sort of that people are attempting to expand it. So perhaps, for instance, you might think of the situation of Black Americans as a kind of fourth world. But here's the idea. So the central thing that frames this theory is that there's this important distinction between states and nations. We tend to conflate those in a lot of realms of discourse, like in the academy, people sometimes use nation states and states or nations interchangeably. According to Gorthold theory, doing that obscures the real reason for a whole bunch of violence. Okay, so here's the idea of the nation. It's a cultural territory made up of communities who see themselves as one people on the basis of a common ancestry. Indigenous nations have a deep connection to the land. They don't have a sort of, like most, what we think of as nation states, have a birth date, right? So like the United States, when was it born?
1776.
What day?
4th of July.
Mexico?
Cinco de Mayo.
Terrible.
Relationship to their to the environment and how they relate to the cosmos, essentially, which is distinct from a nation, from a state, as we'll see in a little bit. So there's self-identifying. I guess this is another point to emphasize here about cultural geography is that there's this worldwide sort of pattern of like places where there's a diversity of indigenous nations. Concentrated wherever there's nations. I'm just going to start referring to them as nations now. Okay. So wherever there's a concentration of nations, there also tends to be a concentration of environmental diversity, of flora and fauna. That's not a coincidence. That's because indigenous people have been traditionally stewards of their environments. They've engineered these environments. So that goes contrary also to like the long-standing colonial justification for a dispossession, which is like that they're idle. Not working the land. Okay. So by contrast, states are what I'm going to call pseudo-nations. They're constructed for the purposes of ordering and organizing societies. They're sort of centralized political, legal creations with bureaucratic, civilian, and military infrastructures that are used to impose one set of institutions on unconsenting nations. They're multinational, meaning that they're composed of many nations. They're not one nation, right? That's why they're a pseudo-nation. They're attempting to become a nation. They're expansionist, meaning that in their attempt to become a nation, they have to destroy other nations. So usually, wherever there's a state, that's the result of the destruction of other nations. Or nations, actually, because right, they're a state, not a nation. Okay, but that also makes them fragile and unstable. So here's some interesting sort of things to know. So let's see. I guess Harry Sell. Yeah. So that comes from Richmond. I think this gives us a sort of really powerful analytical tool, and this is part of the reason why I think we should adopt it. So in the fact that nations have this deep connection to the place that they're at, they're a place-based culture. And because states require the places, those places and their resources, that sets up the collision, right? Mm-hmm. The inevitable collision between these two, what Nietzsche calls like irrepressible forces. most of the wars have been waged from states, by states, on nations, not between states. So the upshot here is that the state is always already sort of a settler entity. Those are settler processes. Okay. This is from a recent anthology by Jorge there, Forging Peoples. Gives it a new meaning, right? That's a violent sort of thing. So, but this is another sort of important thing that if you take away anything today, it will be this thing that I'm about to say from my talk. Okay. Nation building then really just refers to state building by nation destroying. So the nation building is an example of what Nietzsche would call state speak. That is, the correct ways of talking about states. States educate, you know, journalists, academics, and so on, so they can speak about states in their correct ways. They impose these artificial identities by ideological conditioning, common symbols, anthems, doctrine histories, new maps. So here's an example. So you get these sorts of terms, right? Ethnic group really refers, the fourth world translation, really refers to an occupied people in the land. Let's see, a nation, wait, sorry, not that one. So, political integration really means invasion. State economy refers to the systematic plunder of nations. Economic development, occupation and resource plunder. Assimilation, that's just ethnocide. Okay, nations become ethnic groups, right, and minorities in this way of talking in state speak. And ethnic is sort of widely used to mean any non-white people who aren't in power and imply that the group is sort of outside of the original home country, but no nation peoples in the world refer to themselves that way. That's the way that states talk about it. So here's the point. The idea is that you use this sort of language as a way of eliminating the native, right? So it's a settler process. The point is to make it so that the issue of national nation self-determination can't even be raised. So it's even just like the way we talk. Okay, here's an example of how to do it. I would encourage you to try to do it after you read the article. This is another from the Codex Pipeline. So here's his name is Bradley Blakeman. He was a former statesman. Great, I believe. He was in the Bush administration. Here's in favor of the Dakota Access Pipeline, he says, it keeps America's national and energy security rests with our ability to provide our own energy needs with our own natural resources, personnel, and infrastructure. Here's my proposed fourth world translation. The key to securing the state's military capacity and state building interests rests in its ability to exploit the resources of the nations it occupies and to impose enclosures on their lands for state and private plunder. It's fun, isn't it? Try it at home. Which are, you know, voluntary relocations, that reorganized and disrupted indigenous life. life worlds. These were all obviously land grabs. They weren't just labor exploitation and extraction. So the look, it looks different, but the factors are there. It was about capital accumulation, but it was also about disabling indigenous self-determination and about, you know, taking their lands, which basically amounts to the same. Okay, here's another sort of thing about it is that, you know, both the land and the labor, that was the prize that the Crown had promised the participants of the colonial enterprise, and it's also what it needed to extract resources. So I think that we have to include this sort of thing in the analysis that the colonial power. I was actually going to go through a bunch, but I only got like 5 minutes left. A bunch of other examples. So here's one that I'll focus on. So then the Indian town. Okay. I want to focus on this one. Okay. 20th century, 1925, after the Mexican Revolution, Gonzalez publishes The Cosmic Race, where he argues that in Latin America, there's this process that's going to give birth to a new type of civilization that's going to be inclusive of all cultures and races. So you get what people call it, refer to the discourse of the Dominican Sacre. Later on, it sort of becomes a kind of a principle of Mexican citizenship. So you get, and then you get the sort of its counterpart ideology, which is Indigenismo, which was, as Peter Wayne puts it, the idea was, right, that Indians have a special place in the nation. But as Peter Wayne sort of observes, he's a Latin American scholar of race, or a scholar of Latin America, of race in Latin America, he says that it was based more on the glorified romanticization of the pre-Columbian past rather than in respect for contemporary indigenous communities. But here's a mural in Miraflato, which I saw when I was visiting. Is that kind of Miraflato? And it depicts, right, this mestizaje. There's indigenous people, there's the Spaniards, they give birth to a new man who is the ideal Mexican citizen. The Indian then is seen as the origin on a scale of development that culminates with the mestizo. So you derive always Mexicanness from indigenousness. So this is kind of like, you know, the United States doing the Boston Tea Party thing, where the images are of natives, of a certain type of native, right? So like the Aztec warrior become these sorts of the things that you build your own settler identity on. But contemporary Indians, they have to disappear. Okay, I do this thing on land reform. So this is the last thing I'll consider, right? So about the distinction between settler and native. So you might think, well, what do we make of mestizos then? Seems to blur that distinction. So here's my response. I think that we can think of, so even if you think, like, you know, somebody like Guillermo Ponte Platega, who thinks that, you know, all of Mexico really is indigenous, something like that, if you're sort of in that line, you can still, even if you take that line, which is like the previous one, you can still think that indigeneity and settler colonialism can commingle. So here's an example. We were just at, you know, this place we were eating yesterday, where they have California everywhere. So like this in the state, it's our in LA multicultural policies were recognized publicly, or Oaxaca and indigenous communities. But